Okay, please be seated. Just bring the jury in. Okay, please be seated. Let's proceed with direct examination.
Thank you. Mr. Dunlap, before we go on to the next topic, I just have a few follow-up questions on one of the exhibits we left off with before lunch. Could we display exhibit 2M6? You have that in front of you, Mr. Dunlap?
Yes, I do.
I believe you testified this was the same information about dip switches that is contained in some of the Charry Master operational manuals, correct?
Yes.
Now, I think you used the phrase payoff percentages. What were you referring to when you said payoff percentages?
The amount of payout, the percentages that would pertain to how much money individuals playing the machine would receive.
Okay. And those are the 75%, 55%, 70%, 60% numbers that are on that document, correct?
Yes.
And how would you use this information in connection with the actual machine itself?
Say if the particular machine is paying out too much and you wanted to adjust the payout, you would have this information. Again, this deals with dip switch number one. Typically on Charry Master printed circuit boards, there's 5 dip switches. And this is information pertaining to dip switch number one. Only the first 3 settings are being addressed in this post-it note. And there's 8 switches on the dip switch. So using the on-off, say, for 75, you would turn off the first and the second switch, turn on the third, and that would create a 75% payout percentage. Going down to the lowest of 55%, you would turn off the first 3 switches, 1, 2, and 3, and then that would create the 55%. Payout percentage.
And calling your attention to the machine itself, how would you use the information contained on that document in connection with a video machine? In other words, where are the dip switches located that you would have to alter to use this information?
Well, the dip switch, again, this wasn't a dip switch that had this information on the Dodge City. Typically, a dip switch setting of this type would deal with a Charry Master type of machine.
And where are the dip switches located?
And they're located on various positions on the printed circuit board.
And would that be in one of the locked components?
Yes.
Okay. So the person who had this information to use it would have to have access to the locked component, is that correct?
Yes, the person that had this information would have it to use it, and then he would obviously then have control to access the printed circuit board to get to the dip switches. And having that control then would have the knowledge about the percentage of the payouts.
Now, you've testified that this information relates to payout percentages. Would you need this type of information in connection with an amusement device?
No, you wouldn't, because there's no payout percentage on an amusement device. Because using a quarter to play an amusement device, you get all you can, all that amount of amusement that you can on that one quarter, depending on your skill level.
Okay, now let's talk about a different topic for a few minutes. Are you familiar with the with sports bookmaking?
Yes.
Okay, and is that an area that you've worked in your many years of experience that you previously described?
Yes.
And are you able to explain to the jury what sports bookmaking is?
Yes.
Would you explain to the jury what sports bookmaking is?
Sports bookmaking is a business, accepting wagers on sporting events, whether it's football, baseball, basketball, hockey, fights, professional fights, tennis matches. Just talking about the NFL, which is the king when it deals with sports bookmaking. And one of the important aspects of sports bookmaking is establishing a point spread, the line, the odds. And there's two types of odds as it relates to sports bookmaking. You have the point spread, and then you have a money line. And there are odds makers throughout the country and also in the Caribbean who process a lot of information, and they try to come up with that magical number that creates not an even competition on the football field. Again, just using the NFL as an example. They don't try to come up with that magical number to make them evenly competitive on the field, but they create this, try to find this magical number, that line, that point spread, to stimulate wagering on both sides of the contest. Just using the Baltimore Ravens for an example, when they were playing the San Diego Chargers, they want to stimulate wagering on both sides of the contest, because if there's an equal amount of wagering on both teams, then there's a commission that is charged in sports bookmaking. Typically, it's 10%. It's called a juice, a vigorous, a vig, which a bettor must pay the bookmaker on losing wagers. Now, if you go to the licensed sports books in Nevada, if you wager there, you pay the juice up front. If you place a $100 wager, you have to pay them the 10% juice up front, so you're giving the clerk at the sports book $110 to win $100. Now, if you win your wager, you take your ticket to the counter, and the clerk will give you your $100 that you wagered plus the $100 that you won. Now, in the illegal sports bookmaking world, you still charge 10% juice, but illegal sports bookmaking generally operates on credit. You do not have to lay the money up front. You don't have to pay to play when you make your selection when you're placing your bet. But if you do lose your wager in a sports bookmaking operation, a $100 wager, you must then pay your 10% juice. So getting back to one of the basics of sports bookmaking is establishing an accurate, sharp line, as it's called, to make sure that there is equal amount of wagering on both sides of the contest, because the bookmaker doesn't care who wins. He wants to make sure that there's generally a balance in his wagers that he's accepting on both teams, say on the Baltimore Ravens and the San Diego Chargers. And then one's going to win, one's going to lose, and he still is going to make his 10% commission.
Okay. Now, you covered a lot of ground there. I'm going to ask you some specific questions about some of the matters you just discussed. But let's walk through a hypothetical, and maybe this can help. Using your examples, Baltimore Ravens and the San Diego Chargers, okay? Suppose that, or assume that 100 people bet $100 on the San Diego Chargers to win, okay? Follow me there?
Yes.
What would the sports bookmaker want to do in terms of the bets that he accepts for the other teams, the Baltimore Ravens? What would he want to do in terms of accepting bets on the Baltimore Ravens?
Well, a bookmaker will track the amount of wagering that comes in on a particular contest and what moves the line. And again, that magical number is the point spread, the line. And there's a lot of information that is processed depending whether the team is an East Coast team that's traveling to the West Coast, whether it's an afternoon game or a night game or a Thursday night game or a Monday night game where they have a short week, whether the weather conditions, any injury reports, whether it's a grass field or a turf field, even the structure of the stadium. All that information is processed by the odds makers. Typically, they're in Nevada. And they're also in the Caribbean. And they process that information to come up with that magical number. And reference to these amount of people place their wagers on the Baltimore Ravens, what moves the line is money. If too much money is coming in on one side of a contest, then the odds makers then will adjust the line.
Would the object be in the Baltimore Ravens San Diego Charger example, would it be, would the object be to adjust the line? If 100 people bet $100 on the Ravens, would the line move to make sure people start betting on the other team?
Well, it's not so much the number of people, it's the amount of volume.
The volume
that is wagered. Because you don't care about the number of people, you care about the amount of money. But if there's too much money coming in on the Ravens, then the line would be adjusted by the odds makers. And then again, that information, you can access that on the internet or various sources, and then the line will be adjusted to stimulate wagering so more people would bet on the San Diego Chargers.
Okay, assume all those things have happened, and before kickoff on the game, 100 people have bet $100 for the San Diego Chargers to win, and 100 people have bet $100 for the Baltimore Ravens to win. The game's over, and the Ravens win. What happens at that point?
Of course they would win.
Of course.
Then the bookmaker would realize his 10% juice because, again, he doesn't really care who wins the contest. He knows if he's generally in a balance, he will then receive his 10% commission on the losing wager.
So the 100 people who bet the $100, and that's a total, that would be a total of $10,000 wagered, correct?
Yes.
So the $10,000 wagered on San Diego to win would be collected by the sportsbook as losing bets, correct?
Yes, depending, again, with the point spread. That's a number. It's something that also exists. They have to cover the spread. And in sports bookmaking, it says against the spread. Did they cover the spread? Because, again, if the team who was ever a favorite did not cover the spread, then it would be a losing proposition.
Well, just assume for this part of this discussion that the 100 people who bet for the Ravens to win lost, so they would lose the $10,000, correct?
Yes.
That would go to the sports bookmaking business.
Yes.
And the people who bet the $100 for the Baltimore Ravens to win, they would collect $10,000, correct?
That's correct.
Now, would the losing bettors have to pay anything in addition to the $10,000 that they lost?
Collectively, it would be $1,000. 10% juice on the losing wagers. So it would be $1,000 that the bookmaker would have.
Yeah, where would that $1,000, the 10% vig or juice, as you call it, where would that go?
That would go to the bookmaker.
So regardless of the outcome of the sporting event, whether the Ravens win or the San Diego Chargers win, the sports bookmaking business still makes money on the betting activity.
Yes.
So the sports bookmaking business always wins, correct?
Yes.
Objection to the leading, Your Honor.
That's not true.
Overruled.
God's opinion.
Please do not comment on the testimony.
I mean, we have a corrective instruction that this comment is not part of the record. That's
that comment will be stricken.
Thank you.
Your Honor, I'm also having trouble hearing both Mr. Laver and the witness.
Well, speak up. We'll have the witness speak up, please.
Yes, Your Honor.
Now, you talked about the betting lines, correct?
Yes.
Could you explain exactly, what is the information contained in the betting line? Is it a point spread? Are you familiar with that?
Yes.
What is a point spread?
A point spread is, again, that magical number that odds makers try to come up with to create wagering activity on both sides of the contest. Say, for an example, the Ravens are playing Pittsburgh Steelers this coming Sunday. And obviously the Ravens are going to be the favorite. So they would be -3. So
and what does that -3 mean?
That -3 would indicate at the final score, if you bet on the Ravens would have to win that game by more than 3 points. And so that would be subtracted for wagering purposes. That -3 would be subtracted from the total score. So say the score would be the Ravens 21 and Pittsburgh would be 14. So you placed a wager on the Ravens. They covered the spread. So you would subtract that minus 3 from the 21 of the actual score. So for betting purposes, the contest would be 18 to 14. So you covered the spread, and you won your $100 bet if you placed a $100 wager.
And does typically a sports bookmaking business, do they cover different sporting events, or do they specialize in particular sporting events, or what type of activity do they either do they accept bets on?
Various sports bookmaking operations. Since there's no standard operating procedure, each operation will decide on what sporting event they want to accept wagers on. And typically, it's football, NCAA football, the NFL, and NBA basketball, collegiate basketball. And some bookmakers will take a hiatus during the summer and not accept wagers on baseball. Because baseball and hockey, the point spread is not the point spread that I just mentioned. It's a money line. It's another type of odds that is generated. And dealing with the money line, you really don't care who wins that contest. And that's another type of handicapping that is done. Now, and the reason some bookmaking operations do not accept wagers on baseball because you're looking at 162 games in that season. Or compared with the NFL, you're looking at 16 games just in the regular season. So at times it can be very, very difficult to set a sharp line, an accurate line on Major League Baseball because there's so many contests that you have to do the research for and come up with a line. But then there are also sports bookmaking operations that will accept wagers on any sporting event, professional and collegiate. And collegiate is just Division I. And even horse racing and also professional tennis, professional boxing, golf, NASCAR.
And in addition to accepting bets, well, let me backtrack a minute. With respect to the line information that you described, is that something that a person who wants to place a bet with a sports bookmaker, does that person want to know what the line information is?
Yes.
Why would they want to know that information?
Because they want to process that information to determine which team they would want to place a wager on. So,
and when would they want to know that information?
They would want to have that information as soon as possible so they could make an informed decision and then place a wager accordingly.
And is it important from the sports bookmaking business side of the operation, is it important for the sports bookmaking business and the people who work for it to get the line information out to their customers in a timely manner?
Yes, it is.
And why is that?
Because, again, you want to sports bookmaking operation business is a service-based business. And you want to make your bettors very happy, and you want to provide them with all the services in reference to getting accurate line information, getting it to them as soon as you can. And also, if they win, you want to be able to pay them. And if by chance they're indebted to you too much, you don't really want to collect all the money. Again, you want to, getting back to the line, you want to be able to give them the line information as soon as you can.
And are you familiar with the structure of sports bookmaking businesses?
Yes.
We'll talk about that in a little more detail, but who in the sports bookmaking business would be responsible for making sure the lines are provided to the bettors and the people who accept bets on a timely basis?
Those would be individuals involved in the managerial level of the bookmaking operation. These would be individuals that would be referenced to accepting, would be structuring the line, getting accurate lines, disseminating the line, determining credit limits of various bettors, and determining when to pay and collect from various bettors, settling up, which is a common term.
Okay. Yes, when you gave your initial description, you talked about accepting bets. Is it also to sports bookmaking businesses have to pay off bettors?
Yes.
And is it important that they do that in a timely and accurate manner?
Yes.
And why is that?
Because, again, the reason people are wagering on the sporting events, they're doing it because they want to attempt to make money. And if you win, you want to be able to get paid right away.
Now, you've mentioned also in your prior testimony that sports bookmaking businesses, not the ones in Las Vegas, but the other type you were referring to, accept bets on credit.
Yes.
Okay. How does that work? How do you place? How do you make sports bets with a sports bookmaking business on credit?
And that's an important feature of a sports bookmaking operation, to extend a credit to your betting customers. Contrary to, or different than, the sports books in Nevada, where you go to the counter, you have to pay your money up front on a $100 bet. If you call up your bookmaker and place a $100 wager, you don't have to pay him right then and there. And often, with the sports bookmaking operations, these wagers are placed via the telephone. So you call up your sports bookmaker, and you ask them for various lines for the teams that you're interested in. He gives you that line information, and then you will either place your wager then, or you might call him back and place your wager. And then when you do place your wagers, you do not have to pay up front when you place your wager.
Are you familiar with the term bottom figures?
Yes.
Are you familiar with the term settling up?
Yes.
What do those terms mean?
A bottom figure is a figure that is generated by a bettor when he's calling in to a bookmaking operation. Say you place $400 on four teams, and you lost on all four teams. So on that wagering day, your bottom figure would be $400 plus the 10% juice on that $400 wager, which would be $40. So your bottom figure would be $440, which you would owe the bookmaker. And typically in the bookmaking records, that would be indicated as a minus, that you lost. So in the bookmaker's records, it would be a minus 440. And that's the amount of money that you would owe the bookmaker.
And conversely, if the bettor won in the sports bookmaking business owed the bettor, would there also be a bottom figure for the winnings owed to the
bettor? Using the same $400 wagering amount, if you won the $400, the records would indicate next to your name or to your account identifier, plus 400, that the bookmaker would owe you the $400. And again, that tally would typically run week to week, and bookmakers will decide when they want to settle up, whether they want to collect the losing from the bettors and then pay the winners.
Yes, that's my next question. With the phrase settling up, how does that operate?
Again, that's typically settling up. That's typically done throughout the week. It can be done on a Tuesday or a Wednesday, typically after like Monday night football, where the bookmaker will collect money from bettors that owe him money and then pay the bettors that are due the money that have won wagers. And that settling up is done throughout the week.
Okay. Are you familiar with the term pay and collect person or pay and collect man?
Yes.
What is a pay and collect person?
Pay and collect individual is somebody who works for the bookmaking operation, and what his job or his or her job would be at the collection days of the week, the pay and collect days, that they would go around with a tally sheet of the accounts, how much they have to pick up or how much they have to pay, and they will call you or meet you where and collect your money if you owe the bookmaker or pay you if you have won.
Now, are you familiar with the phrase edge work or edging off or laying off, those terms?
Yes.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear the question.
Edge work, edging off.
Repeat the question, please.
Are you familiar with the terms edge work or edging off or laying off?
Yes.
Do those terms all refer to the same thing?
Yes, they do.
Okay, could you explain what those terms mean?
Laying off is, like I mentioned about when wagers are coming in on both sides of a contest. If too much wagering activity is coming in, again, using the Ravens and San Diego Chargers, too much wagering is coming in on the Ravens, the bookmaker will then adjust the line, will move the line to stimulate wagering more on the San Diego Chargers. If that doesn't stimulate equal amount of wagering, then another option he can do, and this is a business decision, he can make a decision to lay off. Say he accepted $10,000 wagers on the Ravens, and there was only $4,000 on the San Diego Chargers. So in essence, he's $6,000 out of balance. So he can call another bookmaker and say, hey, I want to lay off $2,000, $3,000. Laying off in this region in Philadelphia, in Pennsylvania, it's called edge work, edging off. In Arkansas, it's called chopping. But generally laying off, then he's going to minimize his liability for any big loss. And say of the $10,000 wager that he has been accepting on the Baltimore Ravens, he'll lay off part of that. He can lay off all of it or part of it. And he'll lay it off. He may lay off a couple $1,000s with one bookmaker, call another bookmaker up and lay $1,000 off, call another bookmaker, lay $2,000 off.
So essentially the sports bookmaking business is transferring some of the bets to another sports bookmaker.
Yes.
Your Honor, leading.
Yeah. Please do not lead.
So again,
restate the question.
Can you said the bookmaker will lay it off to another bookmaker. Do you recall saying that?
Yes.
Can you explain exactly how that works?
Again, how that's worked, they call him up on the phone and he'll lay off a couple $1,000s. Again, this is a business decision by the bookmaker to minimize any financial liability.
Now, based upon your experience, do sports bookmaking businesses have an organizational structure?
Yes.
What can you describe the organizational structure of a sports bookmaking business?
Yes, but starting from the very bottom with the bettors. You have the bettors, and then you would have possibly agents or clerks who would be accepting these wagers. And then those wagers would then be turned into the bookmaker. And you also have other individuals, pay and collect individuals that would go around and pay and collect, as I described earlier. Then part of this organization, you would have line sources. Bookmaking operation typically would have access to multiple line sources because you want to compare the lines to make sure that the line that you're disseminating to your bettors is as accurate as it can be. Then some organizations, they have a bank who is the financier of the operation, where they provide all the money for the operation. And then you have individuals that will work the phones and accept the bets from the people calling in.
And is there any type of manager or supervisor, to your knowledge?
Well, it could be somebody working, say, the phone spot where the phones are located. And then you can also have other individuals in a bookmaking operation. They're called sub-books, where you have a bettor who, say it's a 50-50, like a split book. Well, this individual is acting as an axillary bookmaker for the main bookmaker, and he shares in the wins and the losses, and he gets 50% of the activity that is generated, of the losses that are generated by the bookmaking operation.
You use the phrase 50-50 book. What does that phrase mean?
Basically, again, splitting the wins and the losses 50-50. It could be a 70-75-25. Also, individuals that are compensated would be, say, clerks who work the phones. They might be giving a commission.
Now, based upon your experience, are sports bookmaking businesses ever backed by organizations?
Yes.
And, what you know about that? Can you explain to the jury how a sports bookmaking business may have an organizational backing?
Well, again, the organizational backing would be individuals that would be providing the finances to run the operation. You would take care of paying the fees for the line sources. There's various line sources that you can get, internet line sources that can be very costly. So a backer would be somebody who would oversee and provide the finances.
And would the backer get a share of the profits of the operation?
Yes.
And how about collection work? Would the backer be involved in any of the collection activities?
Typically, the backer is not involved in the collection. That's in the lower levels of the organization.
The people who work on the streets, so to speak? Or?
Yes.
Okay, now, in preparation for your testimony today, were you provided with copies of a number of recordings that were obtained by the government in the course of this investigation?
Yes.
And did you have an opportunity to review and analyze those conversations?
Yes.
And is that something you typically do in the course of your work as a forensic examiner for the FBI, review and analyze recorded conversations?
Yes.
And did you, based upon your review of the recordings that were supplied to you in this case, were you able to draw any conclusions about the conversations themselves?
Yes.
Okay. Bear with me 1 minute. May I approach the witness at this time?
Yes, you may.
Mr. Dunlop, I'm handing a document that's marked Government Exhibit 5D7. Can you identify what that document
is? This is a FBI laboratory report dated August the 10th, 2011. And it dealt with five compact discs were submitted for the conversations to be analyzed.
And is it correct, according to the report, there were over 300 conversations in this five compact disc?
Yes.
Now, this report is dated August 11th, 2011, correct?
Yes.
Since that date, have you, in addition to the 300 conversations you listened to initially, have you listened to additional conversations provided to you from the case agents in this case?
Yes.
Now, at this time, I'd like to play some conversations, and based upon your training and experience, are you able to interpret words and phrases that were used in those conversations?
Yes.
Are you able to determine whether the conversations were consistent with sports bookmaking activity?
Yes.
You know, at this time, we're going to play some tapes for this witness.
Are they already in evidence?
Some of them are, but not all of them, Your Honor. In fact, Your Honor, after I play the first three tapes, we're going to have to distribute another exhibit book.
Is he able to identify the voices?
Oh, yeah. Oh, Your Honor, it's not. Other people will do that, Your Honor. He's just analyzing the conversations. Okay, the first conversation I would like to play is a conversation identified as Government Exhibit 1-44, and this conversation is located in transcript book number 1.
Your Honor, if I may, before we start the tape, if we could just reiterate the instruction given yesterday. It is a tape that I believe was prepared.
But let me see.
Conversation.
What is it? Book number 1. What is the number?
It's 44. Number 44.
Okay.
And I believe it's a recording made by Peter Albo, and I would ask Your Honor to reiterate the instruction regarding the limiting instruction regarding anything said by Mr. Albo on that tape.
Any objection to that?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. We are going to listen to a recording, and one of the parties is a Mr. Peter Albo. And as I mentioned to you, excuse me, do we need this machine here anymore?
No, Your Honor, we can actually.
Could we remove
Judge,
it so
Judge,
we can?
I will need it for cross examination.
Okay, but let's remove it at least so I can speak to the jury. Yeah, and put it over here, maybe. Mr. Albo is one of the parties to the conversation. Now, anything that Mr. Albo says here is not admitted for the truth of the matter. It's only to provide a context because there are two people in the conversation. So you may not consider anything that Mr. Albo says for substantive purposes, that is, for the truth of the matter of what he's saying.
Okay.
Let's proceed.
Now, Your Honor, the tape we're going to play is identified as Government Exhibit 1-44. The transcript is identified as 1-44A. The transcript for this conversation is located behind tab 44 of transcript book number 1. Do you have that in front of you, Mr. Dunlop?
Yes.
Mr. Dunlap, based upon your training and experience and your review of this conversation, is this a conversation that is consistent with sports bookmaking activity?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Now, during this conversation, the person identified as LB, Louis Beretta, talks at length about a 50-50 book. Did you hear that portion of the conversation?
Yes.
In your opinion, was his description of how a 50-50 book operates an accurate description?
Yes.
Now, I just have a couple questions about the conversation itself. A number of times there's a reference to going in the red. Do you remember hearing that?
Yes.
Can you explain what that term means, going in the red?
It's basically where a red figure is when the bettors owe the bookmaking operation money. It's in the conversation when LB, when Louis Barreto was telling him, if I give you money, that's giving money to P.D. Albo, because P.D. Albo has to pay the bettors that have won. And when any time you have to give the money out, P.D. Albo will not be earning any money.
So what do you mean by that? Albo won't be earning any money if Barreto has to give him money to pay bettors.
Because the only time a bookmaker makes any money is when the bettors are losing.
They get their money from the commissions on the losing bets, correct?
That's correct.
Now, during that conversation, if you go to page 5, at the top of the page at line 3, Mr. Barreto says, we keep track of that every week. Do you have an opinion as to what he meant when he said that, we keep track of that every week?
Well, they keep track of the red figure every week, so the fact that we, meaning that the operation, the bookmaking operation, keeps track of that.
Okay. Now, calling your attention to page 6, lines 10 through 17, Mr. Barreto is telling Mr. Albo about, it starts on Monday, it stops on Sunday, and then it's got to be paid on Friday. Do you have an understanding of what that part of the conversation refers to when Mr. Barreto says it starts on Monday, it stops on Sunday?
That's when Mr. Barreto is giving instructions to Pete Albo about when you pay and collect. When does the wagering week start? And they mentioned in there about Monday Night Football. It changes because of Monday Night Football. So again, Louis Barreto is giving instructions when the wagering week starts and ends.
And that's when the wagering week you described earlier when you're talking about the sports bookmaking business, correct?
Yes.
Now, at this time, the government will play tape identified as Government Exhibit 1-46, and the transcript is identified as Government Exhibit 1-46A, and that transcript is behind tab 46 of transcript book number 1. For the record, that conversation is dated March 6, 2003 at 6:35 p.m. Mr. Dunlap, do you have an opinion of whether that conversation that we just heard is consistent with sports bookmaking activity?
Yes.
And what is your opinion?
When you have various aspects in this conversation, you have an individual calling up for his bottom figure, which would be the 2350, and then...
Calling your attention to page 1 of the transcript.
Yes.
Line 12, the person identified as Michael uses the phrase, you got a count? Is that what you're referring
yes.
to? That's the reference to a bottom figure?
Right. So you have an individual there, Michael, then you have Louis Beretta, and then the Peter Albo calling, and he wants his figure. And Michael gives that to him. It's $2,350. So Michael has that information there. He's at the office where this bookmaking operation is taking place, and it could be somebody's home, somebody's apartment. And then
At the bottom of that first page, line 17, line 16 and 17, Michael says $2,350, and then Alba says $2,350 to the plus. What exactly does that phrase $2,350 refer to?
Well, just from the tone of the voice, I think it's $2,350 that is owed to Peter, because...
Judge, I object to the question and the answer. First, he's assuming something. Second, he's interpreting a conversation to which he's...
Sustained.
Are you able to identify that the reference in the conversation to the phrase $2,350 based upon your training and experience?
Just the $2,350 would be the amount of money that Peter either owes to the bookmaking operation or is owed to him by his betters.
Now look at line 8 on page 2. There's a reference to lines, correct?
Yes.
Now jumping ahead back to the end of the transcript beginning at page 3, lines 19 through 22 on page 4. Are you able to identify what that information is that Mr. Beretta is stating? For example, in line 19 when he says San Antonio 6.5, 82.
Yes, those would be the lines for the National Basketball Association games. The San Diego, dealing with lines, the point spreads. There's the point spread, which is the 6.5, that San Diego would be the favorite. Typically, when the lines are given, it's the favorite that is always given. So San Diego is -6.5. Now, the 82 stands for 182. Another type of line that is very common in football and basketball is an over and under, a total figure. And that is a line, that is a number that is generated by the odds makers that will be provided to the bettors if they want to place a total wager or over and under wager. And that 182, if you want to bet over, you're going to say in that contest, you don't really care who wins the contest, who San Antonio is playing, but you just want to make sure that the amount of the total score of both teams is more than 182. If you bet over, if it's 182, then you've lost that wager. And just like a point line bet with the point spread, if you bet 100, you get back 100. If you bet $100 on the over, and if you lose, you owe $100 plus the 10% juice. And the Golden State, they're the favorite, so it's -3. And then the 07 is 107. That's the total for the over and under. And that continues on with Portland. They're -4, and the over and under is 193.
So all that information provided by Mr. Beretta's statement is line information, correct?
Yes, it is.
And San Antonio would be the name of the sports team that's participating in the event?
Yes.
And 6.5, is that the points?
That's they're the favorites, so it's -6.5 points would be taken away. Now, in the court or the field of play, there's no half points. A half point, commonly it's called a hook. Odds makers will do that because it's almost like another point because you can't. San Antonio has to win that game by at least 7 points for them to cover the spread for wagering purposes.
Now you also described the over-under bet, and that's the last number in that line, 82, that would, or the 182. 82,
yes.
That means 182. Would be
yes, it does.
In the sports bookmaking business, we talked about the example of the San Diego Chargers and the Baltimore Ravens, a bet on the outcome of that contest. Are there different kinds of bets that you can place with a sports bookmaking operation?
Yes, there's many types of bets. The most common are straight bets, and then the over and under. And then there are other types of bets that are typically called exotic type of wagers. And they would be a parlay wager, a teaser, a round robin, an action reverse. Those are various types of wagers that a bookmaking operation can provide their bettors.
And that involves much more information than just the win and loss, winners and losers of the game. Is that correct?
Repeat that?
The teaser bets, the exotic bets, they that requires you have more information than just who won and lost the game, correct?
Yes, it's again, they're in the sports bookmaking industry, they're called exotic wagers. And they're just, again, various types of wagers, reference to providing more points to be used in a teaser wager and a parlay wager, where you're wagering on two events and where you can get more money if you are successful in making a selection on the winning teams.
Now, just on the government will play a conversation that's previously been identified as Government Exhibit 1-57, and the transcript for this one is actually in transcript book number 2. Conversation number 1-57 is behind tab 57 of book 2. Do you have that in front of you?
Agent, maybe he can take this now.
Okay, well, we're looking for the transcript. Yeah. Do you have book 2 in front of you?
Yes, I do.
Okay. And do you have transcript 57 in front of you?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, for the record, this recording is dated April 12th, 2002 at 5:30 p.m. Transcripts behind tab 1, tab 57 of book 2. Play that conversation.
Yes, I have.
Mr. Dunlap, do you have an opinion as to whether this conversation is consistent with sports bookmaking business activity?
Yes, it is.
And what's your opinion?
That it is consistent with activities relating to sports bookmaking, where you have Jay Stone talking to Gary Badalini, and they're talking about, well, one, Jay Stone wanted to place wagers on baseball, and they discuss. And Jay Stone mentioned about LB, Louis Barreto owes me $260. That's a bottom figure that they would be talking about. And then Jay Stone proceeds to give wagers on Toronto, Boston, Denver, Sacramento, Orlando, Cleveland.
You're referring to lines 16 and 17 of page 2, correct?
Yes.
What are they? Do you recognize those names? Toronto, Boston, Denver? Sacramento, Orlando.
It would be NBA.
Professional basketball games.
Yes.
And do you have an opinion as to what the last phrase that Mr. Badalini uses, it's 1550. Do you have an opinion as to what that phrase means?
That would be the total amount of the wagers that would be placed.
Transcript book number 3.
Do you have them there?
They're in the courtroom here.
Okay. Well, let's take our afternoon break now, and we will place them on your seat while we're taking a break, and we'll be back in about 10 minutes. Mr. Makowski, would you place one book on each of the jurors' seats, please? Here, please be seated. Let's bring the jury in. Another hour? Okay. Oh, okay. Are they more comfortable? Because you can lean back?
Yeah.
This is much more comfortable than one that I have. Yeah, we can get rid of it, yeah. Well, we can move them, move somewhere. This is staying here.
Yeah, that would be good. Yeah, put it in there. That's at the head of the jury. Yeah, that's a good place, yeah. Is there one there? Yeah. Yeah, move it along. Oh, this is terrific. And you can move the traffic a little bit, and that helps you. Yeah, and he spoke up, but apparently not from this. Yeah, energy, yeah.
It's got Anthony, it's Arbuthnot. He had got chipped in for a used car.
Yeah. Okay, please be seated. Okay, let's proceed. With your act.
At this time, we'll be playing some tapes that are in transcript book number 3, which have been distributed to the juries, the defense, and to the court. Before we play the next tape, Mr. Dunnett, let me just ask you a few follow-up questions. You testified earlier about how the sports bookmaking business makes money, correct? They essentially make it off the 10% commission, is that correct?
Yes.
Does the volume of betting activity accepted by the sports bookmaking business have anything to do with how much money the sports bookmaking business makes?
Yes.
What's the relationship between the volume of betting activity and the money that the sports book business makes?
Because if the sports bookmaking business accepts a lot of money, then there's a good chance that they would, you know, they would get more of the commission from the losing wagers. So the more you accept, there's a chance that you could, again, if you balance your book and make a wise business decision, you will get more of your 10% commission.
Now, at this time, the government will play a tape recording, which is identified as Government Exhibit 1-116. The transcript for this recording is behind tab 116 of book 3. And just by way of preliminary caution, there are actually two transcripts behind tab 116, 116A and 116-1A. The first conversation that we're going to play ends at page 2. Do you have that in front of you, Mr. Dunlap?
Yes, I do.
Mr. Dunlap, are you able to determine, based upon your training and experience, whether this conversation is consistent with sports, with the activity of a sports bookmaking business?
Yes.
And what is your opinion?
Well, when you have a discussion where Louis Beretta asked Damien Canaluccio, what was the balance?
Now, I'm going to object at this point in time. I know that they are going to later lay the foundation as to who the speakers are, but speakers
as to what, as to who the voices
speakers are.
Yes.
But there's no testimony regarding that now, and I don't believe the speakers are accurate in this conversation. I have no objection to him testifying as to the words in
the
conversation. The identity of the speakers, I take objection to.
Okay. What line are we talking about?
The entire conversation, with the exception of line 2.
Yeah, this witness is not being offered for purposes of voice identification. It's being offered as an expert to analyze.
Well, I think what you're saying is that he can talk about the words, but not who the speakers are.
Yes, you know, his attribution is just simply to the transcript attributions. He's not identifying the speakers. Do you understand that?
The only problem is that the transcript identifies the speakers. As we know, the transcripts are not evidence, but any reference by the witness to the fact that the speakers are correctly identified, I would ask that not be done at this time, Your Honor.
Well, okay. Well, let's just go over to what this all means. It means that although the transcript has certain identifications, you should disregard those identifications in this particular transcript, because we have not had a witness yet who has identified the voices. So disregard the identifications, and the witness will simply talk about the text, but not about the identification of the speakers.
And Mr. Dunlap, if I call your attention to a particular line that has a reference to a name, I'm not asking you to identify the speaker. Just that's just for reference purposes.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Now, my question to you was: do you have an opinion as to whether this conversation is consistent with the activity of a sports bookmaking business? And you said yes, correct?
Yes.
And I asked you to explain your opinion, and that's where we left off.
Yes.
Okay. Could you do that now?
Because on line 13, the question is asked, what was the balance? And then the response from line 14 is, I'm just looking for 25.80. They're talking, excuse me, they're talking about bottom figures. And there's a discrepancy about the bottom figure, because on line 16, the 25.35. And then the conversation continues about knocking off 280 from the last week. That's a carryover figure from the previous week. So again, the two participants in this conversation are discussing bottom figures. And then on the second page, on 5, it stated, I got to give you 2245. That's 2245, and that's $2,245. And they're discussing about what time. And then down on line 12, well, on line 10, they use the term, I don't care about the middle money. Middling is a wagering practice in sports bookmaking operation. And what a middle is when a line is disseminated, if individuals feel that that's not a very accurate line, they'll wager on that contest. And then they'll track the line movement throughout the week. Maybe the next day it might change. And if there's a line movement, then what a bettor can do or what an individual can do is it then place money on the other side of the contest, again, using the Ravens and San Diego. If you place wagers on both sides of the contest, you could possibly middle it, meaning if the score falls in the appropriate, if the score is the appropriate result, you could actually middle the game, basically winning both contests. Now, if you place a $100 wager on the Ravens and a $100 wager on San Diego, you could possibly win $200. But if the score doesn't fall into that middle where and you do not win both of the contests, you're going to win one, you're going to lose the other. So you're going to be at the 10% juice. So it is a wagering strategy that individuals participate in a sports bookmaking operation. And this individual is saying, I don't care about the middle money. I don't need that. I don't want that now. I just need this money first. And, you know, he says, I just need that money. You know, you can give me the middle money later on.
Well, in fact, calling your attention to line 10, the person identified as DC says, I got to pay these people now. I don't care about the middle money. Based upon your training and experience, do you have an opinion as to what the phrase, I got to pay these people now, means?
Yes, that individual would have to. He needs the money from the bookmaker because then he has to pay these people. These people would be individuals that would be betting into the bookmaking operation.
At this time, the government will play a tape identified as one Government Exhibit 1-116-1A. And the transcript is identified as 1-116-1A. And that is immediately behind page 2 of tab 116. For the record, this is a conversation dated February 11th, 2006 at 12:44 a.m. For the complete the record, the conversation identified as 1-116 was dated February 10th, 2006 at 4:01 p.m. Do you have the transcript for 1-116-1A in front of you?
Yes.
Okay. Let's play that conversation.
Yeah. Hey. Yeah. I truly apologize. Yeah. No,
Mr. Dunlap, do you have an opinion based upon your training and experience whether the conversation we just listened to is consistent with the activity of a sports bookmaking business?
Yes, it is.
And what is your opinion?
That is consistent with that activity of a sports bookmaking.
And why is that?
Operation. Because you have the caller identified by DC calling another individual, discussing with another individual about paying up. Obviously, this other individual in wagering with this bookmaking operation incurred some debts. He owed money, and he didn't pay up. And then information obviously was, well, then this individual was betting with other people. So this DC individual is, in essence, reading this individual the Riot Act. You got to pay up first. You got to pay my friends first before you go betting with other people. So DC has some interest, some concern, some control about this operation.
Your Honor, objection. Goes yes. to state of mind.
Yes.
Move to strike.
That's, the motion is granted. What the speaker intended is not part of the subject matter of the expert's opinion in this case. It's simply what the words are and what those words are construed, but not what's inside the speaker's mind.
Calling to your attention to page one of that transcript, line 16, the person identified, referred to as DC, says you didn't pay last week's bets. Do you have an opinion as to the phrase last week's? Does that have any significance in connection with the sports bookmaking business?
Again, a sports bookmaking operation business surely goes from week to week, depending on the season. So this individual, obviously, as it stated, didn't pay his wagering activity last week.
Okay. Your Honor, at this time we will play the next recording. This is a recording identified for the record as dated February 11th, 2006. The time of the recording is 4:12 p.m. It's identified as Government Exhibit 1-117. And the transcript that corresponds to this recording is behind tab 117 of Book 3. That's identified as Government Exhibit 1-117A. Do you have that in front of you, Mr. Dunlap?
Yes, I do.
Let's...
Talking about. I said, what do you need, buddy? Do we got the rights? wasting money, but pretty good at that. You know, whenever I work, maybe the work the guy started the week. Like, how are you going to do that? How are we going to start listening? You know, we only 20,000, but we're going to put that on hold. You can't get out. Like, there's no way to work now. I don't think that, you know. I don't. You seem to tell me that, and I was actually going to run out and be amazed and turn around and say, Venus, because they'll say, you know, if we're on 20, we're 20, we're even.
Right.
So if we're not getting back to the boat, I have a fucking order. Like, it's dead. Which is a shame, because the price will be pretty good. I don't know, because I wish it was the other way around, where you go, cheap.
Right, right.
But see, you know what? I'm quite in the middle of the way, because you're on one side, you're on the other. So if the guy beats him, I'm going to hear about it. And if the guy beats you, I'm going to hear about it. And you're saying, so I'm like, that's fucked up.
Right.
I'm going to somewhere else.
Yeah, like if we go to the galley, like the witch or something like that, you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. Something like that would be great.
I mean, I'm trying to tell you what, because the cat is all you want.
Well, that's what, man, I'm saying. There's something wrong over here. You know, you got money,
Mr. Dunlap, do you have an opinion as to whether the conversation we just listened to is consistent with the activity of a sports bookmaking business?
Yes, it is.
And what is your opinion, and could you explain your opinion, please?
It is consistent with the activities of a sports bookmaking operation. You have an individual, JM, conversing with DC. JM's concerned because apparently he referred another book to an individual by sheep. And this individual won 6 out of 6 games, won a lot of money. Apparently, the bookmaker cannot pay. So DC and JM are discussing this, and they're concerned. JM is concerned about other people coming and doing harm, or coming to him. But all he did,
sustained. Okay. Sustained. You have to ask some of us specific questions. General questions.
Let's go through
specific
it.
Terms yes. That may indicate that.
Let's go through it line by line, Mr. Dunlap.
Relevant lines.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, can we?
Yeah. Yeah. I think I have given everybody fair warning, and there will be a hearing after today's the matter is disposed of to attend to comments that have been made. Let's proceed.
Thank you. Mr. Dunlap, calling your attention to page 1 of the transcript that we just of the conversation we listened to, lines 15 and 16. The person identified as JM says he stuck a bundle. He went 6 for 6. Do you have an opinion as to what those terms mean?
He won 6 games. He wagered on 6 games, and he won on those 6 games.
And then calling your attention to page 2, line 4, the person identified as JM says he hit him for 13 dimes. Do you have an opinion as to what that means, 13 dimes?
That's $13,000 a dime, and sports bookmaking terminology reflects a $1,000 wager. to 13 dimes would mean $13,000.
Now, calling your attention to page 3, at page line 7 through 10, actually, let me just back up a minute. No, I'm sorry. Page 3, lines 7 through 10, the end of that conversation, that portion of the conversation, the person identified as JM says, what if they move on me? Do you have an opinion as to what JM was referring to when he used the phrase, if they move on me?
No, not what he was referring to.
I'm sorry, Your Honor. Do you have an opinion as to what that phrase means, if they
objection,
move on me?
That's the very same objection I made earlier. He's going to have to read JM's.
Yeah, I think that the expert can provide an opinion as to certain terms that are used in a sports bookmaking transaction, but not what was intended by the speaker or what he meant by what he said. So please, let's stay with that program.
Yes, sir. Now let's look at your line 23 of page 3. The person identified as DC says, we'll just see how the week goes. Do you have an opinion as to what the phrase the week goes means in that context?
That would be the wagering week.
Now, moving forward to page 5 of the transcript, looking at the portion of the conversation that corresponds to lines 2 through 5. You see that portion of the transcript?
On page 5?
Page 5, lines 2 through 5. During that conversation, the person identified as JM says, I'm hoping Sheep gets some get back. Do you have an opinion as to what the phrase get back means in that context?
The Sheep is the individual that JM referred this better to, better slash bookmaker to, and the get back would be that hopefully that Sheep would win some.
And the better would lose some.
Yes.
That would be additional sports bets.
That would be correct, yes.
Objection's the leading
yes,
line.
Yes, it's leading question. Let the expert testify.
Yes, Your Honor. Now, line 5, the person identified as JM uses the phrase, turn him over to somebody else. Do you have an opinion as to what that phrase means in that context?
If a bookmaker can't handle the amount of wagering activity from a particular individual, then the reference here is to turn him over to another bookmaker who could accept the wagering activity.
Now, calling your attention to page 6 of the transcript, line 14 through 16, the person identified as JM uses the phrase, I'm hoping he gets out between tonight and tomorrow. Do you have an opinion as to what that phrase means, gets out between tonight and tomorrow? You see that on line 14 to 16.
No, I don't have an opinion on that phrase.
Okay. Now, calling your attention to line 18 of page 6, the person identified as JM makes a reference to, uses the phrase, he edged some of it out. Do you have an opinion as to what that means?
Yes.
What is your opinion for that phrase?
That the Sheep possibly laid off some of the wagers that he received from this individual.
Now, calling your attention to page 7 of the transcript, lines 9 through 10, the person identified as DC uses the phrase, $100 guy, and then later on in the same conversation, two dimes a game. Do you have an opinion as to what those phrases mean in that context, $100 guy and two dimes a game?
Now, the $100 guy would refer to an individual, a bettor, that would be placing a $100 wager, and that consistently the wagering amount. But then this individual is wagering two dimes, $2,000 a game.
Now, calling your attention to the portion of the conversation between line 13 and 27, conversation between JM and DC, there's a number of references to the phrase stuck them. For 90,000, stuck them for 20-something. Do you see that? Do you recall hearing that word?
Yes.
Do you have an opinion as to what that word means in that context, stuck? For example, if you take a look at line 15 there, if you have an opinion, where he says, I said, you know, how much he stuck with this week, this with this guy.
And that would be the amount of money that a bettor won from the bookmaking operation.
Now, calling your attention to page 8, lines 3 through 5. The person I referred to as DC makes the comment that settle up at a certain amount. Should have done the thing where you settle up at a certain amount. Do you have an opinion as to what that phrase means in that context, settle up at a certain amount?
Yes. Basically, DC is telling JM that you should set amount that you should stick with and settle up. And the suggestion, the comment is, say, at 5,000, settle up at 5,000. If you settle up at that amount, then you won't be in a situation like this where you have owe a lot of money to a bettor.
Based on your analysis of this conversation, are you able to determine how much money was owed to the bettor? Well, I'll withdraw that question. I'll ask that to you at a later point in the conversation. Let's sticking on page 8, looking at line 20 through 23, the person I identified as JM makes a reference to trying to make 10%. You're only trying to make 10%. Do you have an opinion as to what that phrase, make 10%, means in the context of this conversation?
Yes, the 10% will be referring to the commission, the juice, the vigorous that is charged in losing wagers.
Now, calling your attention to page 9, lines 12 and 13, the person identified as DC uses the phrase, he's going to have to settle something. Do you see that portion of the conversation?
Yes.
Do you have an opinion as to what that phrase means in the context of sports bookmaking activities, settle something?
Well, the settle this issue, where Sheep is the bookmaker that JM referred this individual to, who won 6 for 6 games, and JM is concerned about it.
Objection, Your Honor. It's going to the state of mind of the speaker.
Sustain.
Okay.
Mr. Donald, in answering the question, just go to the interpretation of the words. Do you follow that without trying to talk about anyone's particular state of mind?
This would be reference to settling up the situation here.
Now, if you look at page 11, lines 25 through 26, person identified as JM makes this statement, we can move the guy starting the new week. Do you have an opinion as to what the phrase the new week means in that context?
Yes, the new wagering week.
Now, calling your attention to page 14, the lines 3 through 4. I asked you earlier the question, based upon your analysis of this conversation, were you able to determine the amount of that the bettor won from the sports bookmaking operation? Are you able to answer that question now?
Yes, it would be $23,000.
Okay, at this time, the government will play a conversation identified as Government Exhibit 1-118. The copy report the transcript from the government. Government Exhibit 118-A. For the record, this is a conversation dated February 17th, 2006 at 6:31 p.m. Do you have that in front of you?
Yes, I do.
Okay, let's play that conversation.
Yeah, I'm not going to ask you. Come here. I'm sure.
Mr. Dunlap, do you have an opinion as to whether this conversation is consistent with the activity of a sports bookmaking business?
Yes.
And what is your opinion?
That it is consistent with activities of a sports bookmaking operation or business, where LV is stating that he apparently laid off the edge, $49,000 is owed on the edge, which would be the layoff wages that were placed.
Okay. And there's a reference to, on page one at line 10, there's a reference to the name Rick. You've listened to all these conversations. Are you able to identify that reference, Rick?
No.
Okay, at this time, the government will play recording identified as Government Exhibit 1-119. The transcript is behind tab 119. The transcript is identified as Government Exhibit 1-119, and for the record, this is a conversation dated February 18th, 2006 at 3:19 p.m. Do you have that in front of you?
Yes.
Okay. Play back. Mr. Dunlap, do you have an opinion as to whether this conversation is consistent with the activity of a sports bookmaking business?
Yes.
And what is that opinion?
That it is consistent with the activities of a sports bookmaking business, where the discussion by LB is referring that he called an individual reference who was expecting payment of money, and that it was explained to him that he couldn't be paid that amount of money.
And during that conversation, person identified as LB, calling your attention to line 11 and 12 of the transcript, uses the phrase, "they can't handle my work." Do you have an opinion as to what that means, what that phrase means in that context?
The amount of wagering activity, the volume of the wagering activity.
Okay, and there's a, during the same conversation, let me just find it here for 1 minute. Actually, it's at line 4. Mr. Beretta uses the phrase, "I pay my guys on Saturday." Are you able to, do you have an opinion as to what that phrase, "pay my guys on Saturday," means in this context?
That would be paying the bettors that would be involved in the bookmaking operation.
Now, at this time, we're going to play the next conversation, which is identified for the record as Government Exhibit 1-120. There are actually two portions to this conversation, and we will only play the first segment, which for the transcript is identified as Government Exhibit 1-120A. Segment 1 is the first three pages of the transcript, which is behind tab number 120. And for the record, this conversation is dated February 22nd, 2002 at 12:40 a.m. Do you have that in front of you?
It's February 22nd, 2006.
2006, sorry, I misspoke. Yes. Okay, do you have that?
Yes.
Okay, let's play this conversation.
I got to do it. I don't care if he goes back and have another guy, I don't give a fuck. Just put him to
Mr. Dunlap, do you have an opinion as to whether this conversation relates to the activity of a sports bookmaking business?
Yes.
And what is that opinion?
And it would be consistent with that activity of a sports bookmaking business.
Okay. Let's just take a look at page 2 of the transcript, lines 6 through 7. During that portion of the conversation, the person identified as DC makes the statement, he's up 10. Are you able to, do you have an opinion as to what that phrase means, he's up 10, in the context of this conversation?
That would be $10,000.
Later on in the same conversation, the same person makes the reference, going to take a shot with the guy. Do you have a reference as to what, do you have an opinion as to what that phrase means in that, in the context of this conversation?
No.
If you do.
Yeah. No.
Okay. And a little bit earlier on, line 4, person identified, referred to as DC, uses the phrase a nickel, the term a nickel. Do you have a understanding, do you have an opinion as to what the phrase a nickel means in the context of this conversation?
A nickel in sports bookmaking terminology refers to a $500 wager.
Now, at this time, we'll play the conversation identified as Government Exhibit 131. You know, just for the record, there are a number of transcripts in this portion of the transcript books that we're not going to be using this, with this witness. I'll call out the transcript that we're actually going to use, so the next witness will be...
Okay. Okay, let's take a five-minute break here.
Was that 131 or 121?
'Bring the jury back. Okay, please be seated. Okay, let's proceed, please.
At this time, the government will play a recording identified as Government Exhibit 1-131. For the record, the recording is dated March 17th, year 2006, at 10:11 p.m. The transcript for this conversation is behind tab 131, and the transcript is identified as Government Exhibit 1-131A.
Right. what I'm trying to say?
No, I know you're right.
But I'm doing it because it's the right thing to do. I'll tell you what. What are you upset about? What do you want to talk about? Give you a month. I mean, I can see a guy that went around here with no money. Thank you, officer.
Now, we had a situation, and we didn't know it. You're right. We knew. You said we won, but what the fuck? Shit happens to them.
Exactly.
And, you know, he took me there. I didn't see him, but when we did, I said, listen, I said, you know, he'll be coming off too, but, you know, we're going to get away. He said, we didn't wait. I said, you got to wait. I said, if I'm not waiting, you know, you got to wait. I said, he's good for the money. I said, we didn't score change up, but okay. And he never brought up to me again. Never called me. He said, one time, wait.
Of course, because my wife, he could talk to the that.
Good.
I probably lost that
shit. What the fuck
are
you looking for, you, dude?
Yeah.
You know, only come up to, you know, use a couple hours and call me out if I lose
it. Yeah, exactly.
You know what I'm saying? I got that phone, babe. Where am I? I don't understand that. You know, for that money, and, you know, I ain't enough. You call me a loser. That's why you ain't talking to me.
I didn't like that, dude. I didn't like that.
Yeah. You look back and forth, you tell me shit like that, but you fuck out back and forth shit. You know, you guy, a fucking guy loses fucking 30,000 a week. Just come to the shop, everything. You know, he's here for you. Yeah, what the fuck? I mean, this fucking, he is nothing, not a nickel. I ain't gonna come to your stomach and see a wolf. Once you realize that I knew that the amount that you were actually losing before you, you know, you get lost.
Mr. Dunlap, do you have an opinion as to whether this conversation is consistent with the activity of a sports bookmaking business?
Yes.
Okay. And what is that opinion?
It's a discussion about settling up and paying individuals involved in the bookmaking operation.
Okay. Now, there's a reference, page 1 to line 10, is a reference to the Carl situation. In the context of this conversation, can you do you have an opinion as to what type of person Carl is, or not what type of person, or what? Why are they referring to Carl in this conversation?
Judge, I object to that. He would have to be a conversant here.
Yeah, I'll withdraw the question. I'll move it. Did you, in the course of listening to all these conversations, did you hear any other conversations that made reference to a person named Carl?
A few, but I can't recall them.
Can't recall them?
No.
Okay. Let's move on. At the bottom of page 1, there's a reference to page line 21. There's a reference to the phrase 10-pack. Do you have an opinion as to what that phrase means, a 10-pack? And if you continue, top of page 2, line 1, there's a reference.
Sorry, because I didn't hear an answer to that.
I'm calling the witness's attention to additional information they may. Bottom of line, page 1, line 21, there's a reference to the phrase 10-pack. And then at top of page 2, line 1, there's a reference to the phrase 5 dimes each. Do you have an opinion as to what those phrases mean in the context of this conversation?
Well, the 5 dimes would be 5,000. And the 10-pack would be 10,000. Now, again, this conversation could be referenced to a loan when it talks about $150 a week.
You're referring
to Your Honor, to what it could be and move to strike.
You're referring to the top of page 2, correct?
Yes.
Is it in your training and experience, do sports bookmaking businesses also loan money to people that do business with them?
Yes, that's a service a bookmaking operation will provide. If you're indebted to a bookmaker, often a bookmaker will hook you up with an individual, a loan shark, somebody that would lend you money. And then you would structure the payment, and there's various types of loans, whether it's a juice loan or a knockdown loan. And this $150 a week indicate to me that this would be a knockdown loan.
Could you explain just briefly what does the 150 refer to?
The weekly payment. The weekly payment on a loan.
On a knockdown loan.
Yes.
Now moving, calling your attention to page 4, lines 8 through 10. During that conversation, the person referred to as DC makes a statement, what do you want to do? You got to wait. Are you able, based upon your training and experience, to identify those phrases as being relating to sports bookmaking activity?
Yes, dealing with an individual that would be receiving money from a bookmaker, and if the bookmaker can't pay, then the bookmaker will say, well, you just have to wait. You have to wait until I get my money, so then I can give you your money.
Now, moving forward to page 5, calling your attention to lines 8 through 10. Person identified as DC makes a statement, the guy loses effing $30,000 a week, and then he uses the phrase, you got to come with me something, got to come to me with something. Do you have an opinion based upon your training and experience what the reference to the phrase, you got to come with me with something, means in the context of this conversation?
The something would be some minimal amount of payment on that $30 money that is owed, to make some sort of gesture to say, I can't pay you all the 30, but here's at least 1,000 or 2,000, something towards that $30,000 amount.
Okay. And is that a statement that would be consistent with somebody who's, would that be a statement made by somebody who would that be a statement consistent with somebody who is, has a, you all testified earlier about the structure of the sports bookmaking business?
Yes.
Would that statement that you just referred to, would that be consistent with somebody who's has a position within the sports bookmaking organization or business?
Your Honor, I would object.
Speculation, yeah. Wild speculation. Now,
right.
Let's focus on particular code words that have something to do with this. Let's not just go in the realm of imagining things, okay? So yes. Let's focus in here. It's 4 o'clock.
Bottom of page 5, line 22, the person referred to as LB makes the reference, peace him out. Do you have an opinion as to what that phrase means in the context of that conversation, peace him out?
No.
Okay. Now, at this time, we'll play the conversation identified as Government Exhibit 1-138. For the record, the transcript is behind tab 138. The conversation is dated April 10th, 2006. For the record, it's the time of the conversation is 7:39 p.m. And the transcript is identified as 1-138A, and it's behind tab 138. Do you have that in front of you, Mr. Dunlop?
Yes, I do.
Okay, can we play that conversation now? Mr. Dunlap, do you have an opinion as to whether this conversation is consistent with the activity of a sports bookmaking business?
Yes.
And what is that opinion?
That it is consistent with those activities.
Now, calling your attention to page 1 of the transcript, line 4, is the phrase, the person identified as LB uses the phrase, I ain't going to deduct it out. Do you have an opinion as to what that phrase means in the context of this conversation, deducted out? If you have
what line are you on?
Line 3 and 4 of page 1. You see that where?
Yes, deducted out would mean reduce it from the amount of money that would be owed to the bookmaking operation.
And calling your attention to page 2, lines 4, line 4, person identified as LB makes reference to the phrase a balance of 18,000. And later on, lines 6 through 8, the person identified as LB uses the phrase we split 600. In your opinion, does that part of the conversation relate to sports bookmaking activity?
Yes.
What does the phrase we split 600, do you have an opinion as to what the phrase we split 600 means?
That there are participants in a bookmaking operation and they're sharing in the losses and the wins of the bookmaking operation.
Yeah, at this time, Mr. Dunlap, I want to show you some records. So you can put the transcript book aside for a minute. Again, to your knowledge, calling your attention to the time period of June of 2006, previously testified you participated in the execution of some search warrants with the FBI at that time in Philadelphia, correct?
Yes.
And in connection with that, the execution of those search warrants, were certain documents seized as well as some video poker machines?
Yes.
And were you asked by the Philadelphia Field Division of the FBI to do anything in terms of your forensic work in connection with those exhibits, those documents that were seized during the search?
Yes, to conduct an examination of the documents.
And did you do that?
Yes.
I'll place before you a document that's previously been identified as Government Exhibit Number 5D4. Now, with the court's permission, I hand this to the witness.
Okay.
Are you able to identify what this document is, Mr. Dunlap?
Yes, this is the FBI laboratory report that was issued on the examination of the records that were seized on June the 1st, 2006.
Okay, I'll show you some of these records individually in a few minutes, but based upon your forensic analysis of the records and documents that were seized during those searches, were you able to reach an opinion as to whether or not the documents related to sports bookmaking activity?
Yes, these documents did relate to that activity.
Let me first hand you a document that's previously been marked, two documents, marked 2L2 and 2L3.
Anybody have any objection to these? There's no objection. They can.
Yeah, they'd be admitted.
Okay. Honor, may I approach the witness?
Yes.
Mr. Dunlap, I'll place in front of you two items that have been marked 2L2 and 2L3. Are you able to identify what those items are?
Yes, these are two Nevada sports rotation schedules. They're two booklets that are published that have the schedules for the various sporting events, professional and amateur sporting events, for throughout the year. One is the premium sports schedule, and the other, 2L2, is the DonBest.com sports schedule.
So maybe you display those exhibits for the jury for some? This is 2L2 in front of you?
Yes.
And what information is contained in that? You said it was a rotation schedule?
Yes.
What information is contained in that rotation?
Well, the Don Best, donbest.com, again, it's a listing of the college football games and the professional football games. It has the reason the rotation, Nevada sports rotation phrase is used at the sports book. All the sports that are listed on the tote boards when you're making your wager, they have typically a three-digit number. And as with in these booklets, the various sporting events have a three-digit number. So you have a college football, and
can we just go to one of the pages that you're referring to? The display is the cover page of that, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Looking at that page, can you explain what information is contained on that page?
Okay, on the, if you,
okay.
The rotation number, the 207 for the San Diego Chargers. Again, these are pre-printed booklets, and individuals in bookmaking operations will use this as reference materials to keep track of the schedule of the contest, and they will also be used to record various information. They'll record line information, any line movements throughout the week, and the plus four and the three are the line movements, and at times they will also indicate the like an over and under what the line is, and they use this as reference material.
Now, is there line information on that page that you're looking at?
Yes.
Can you point out what is the line information?
Well, you have for the San Diego Chargers, you have 48, and then you have plus three, and then plus four, then three. And this would be the line changes throughout the week.
Now, Exhibit 2L3, is that the same type of document?
Yes, it is.
Contain the same type of information?
Yes.
Is that also a document that would be used in connection with the operation of the sports bookmaking business?
Yes, bookmakers will use this to track the information, as I mentioned earlier.
For the record, those items were seized by the FBI on June 6th, 2006, at a property identified as 2525 Mole Street, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. This time I'm going to show the witness document mark 2L4.
You may.
Yes.
Can we maybe publish that? Is there any objections to the
move? No.
Admit it.
May we publish that document to the jury? Before you use the cover page, correct?
Yes.
Let's go into the contents of the notebook. Okay, you see that page in front of you?
Yes.
Okay. Frank, I know the pages aren't numbered, but if you can just identify which page we're at.
Looking at the page that's displayed on the screen in front of you, Mr. Dunlap, do you recognize any of your handwriting?
Yes, my initials are on the top right.
Okay. And for purposes of identification, can you, the numbers that are next to your handwriting,
this would be the first page. This would be the first page in this booklet.
Now, first, let me ask you this. Did you conduct a forensic analysis of the contents of this notebook?
Yes.
And did you were you able to reach any opinion as to whether or not this book relates to the activity of a sports bookmaking business?
Yes, it does.
And now taking a look at what you've identified in the first page, can you explain why you reached that conclusion, particularly with reference to the information that's contained on the pages inside the notebook?
Well, Well, on this particular page, it has line information. The St. Louis minus 7.5. That's what the first entry states, and then Texas plus 7.5. Detroit plus 6. And over Seattle is 8.5. And then you have on the right-hand side, you have a the number of 4250 plus and 4250 again with two initials, an S and a J. And that would indicate to me that there's a split of the proceeds of the wagering activity involved in this operation.
Now, you've analyzed the contents of all the pages, correct?
Yes.
Drawing your attention to page 5 of your forensic report. I'm not sure if I handed that to you. Do you have a document identified as Government Exhibit 5D4 in front of you?
Yes.
Is that a copy of your forensic report of analysis of certain gambling records dated December 28th, 2007?
Yes.
And is it correct that page four and page six contain some analysis of this particular item? Is that correct? I think it's referred to as Q11. Q1110, I believe.
Yes.
Okay. Now, just take a look at the last page of your report. Is that a summary analysis of some of the wagering activity you identified in this particular item?
Well, it was in this booklet, and there was also some other documents, too.
And just calling your attention to page 5 of your report, if you refresh your recollection, were there days on, according to your analysis of the record, were days when wagering activity exceeded the amount of $2,000 in wages?
Yes.
What days were they?
On August the 19th, 2005, it was $1,100.
The question is, did they exceed $2,000 wagering activity?
Yes.
Okay. Which days?
And those dates would be September the 3rd, 2005, October the 2nd, 2005, October the 4th, 2005, November the 11th, 27th, and 28th of 2005.
And was there also an entry on your report for February 27th, 2006?
Oh, yes. Thank you.
What was the total, in your analysis, what was the total of the wagering activity for the days that you analyzed?
The total wagering activity was $101,850.
And is correct, that covered the period of August 19th, 2005 through February 27th, 2006?
Yes. Well, there were $5,000 of undated wagering activity.
Okay, so the one entry you couldn't attribute a date to, correct?
Yes.
Now, this time I'm going to hand you some documents that were seized from another location during the execution of a search warrant on June 1st, 2006, and for the record, and this will be established by another witness, these documents were seized at a location identified as 2519 South Colorado Street in Philadelphia. First exhibit I'm going to hand you is exhibit marked 202.
2519 South.
Oh, okay. 2519 South Colorado Street.
I have no objection to that.
Yeah, he said admit it.
May we, may I approach the witness, Your Honor?
Yes, you may.
I'm handing you document 202. And asking you to identify that.
This is a Nevada sports rotation schedule, DonDesk.com, for baseball for Wednesday the 30th, 2006, up to July the 11th, 2006.
You show one of the content pages, the internal pages of that document, that contains the same type of information
sorry, I'm having a hard time hearing the questions.
Is this, take a look at the page that's exhibited in front of you. Does this contain the same type of information that you described when we reviewed the other rotation schedules a few minutes ago?
Yes. Reference to line information, pitchers, because this is dealing with Major League Baseball. And, again, line information, pitchers that are scheduled to pitch on that particular day. And there's also handwritten information about the National Hockey League lines and also National Basketball Association lines that are handwritten at the bottom of the page.
And is this a document and information that would be used in connection with the sports bookmaking business?
Yes. The sports bookmaker would use this as reference material.
Yes, you may.
Hand you a document mark 203, item mark 203, identify that.
Yes, this is a torn piece of paper with the baseball line information from a newspaper.
The next exhibit is mark 204.
This is a note tablet that has writing on the very first page, and the writing would be consistent with a bottom sheet.
May we display the first page of the note tablet? Can you explain how you identify that as a bottom sheet?
Bottom sheet is a document that contains accounting information of a sports bookmaking operation, where you would have on the left-hand side, you have writings indicating account designations, which would identify participants of the bookmaking operation. And then you would have a bottom figure, like the first entry there is plus 1,500, then the second is VC plus 200. And this is important in the managerial level of a bookmaking operation, because this shows the indebtedness. This shows the indebtedness of the bookmaking operation, of money being paid out to bettors or money being paid into the operation.
The numbers, the columns on the left-hand side, would they correspond to bettors that are placing bets with the sportsbook?
Well, some of them are, but then there are some indications of some names in here that I've identified through analysis of these records that they would be identified as bookmakers. So with these names listed here, this again possibly this would indicate that these individuals, the person that would write the information on this, was wagering with these other bookmakers.
Yeah, in your prior testimony, you made reference to the subbook. Would some of these names refer to subbook?
A subbook or a layer.
There's no foundation for this testimony.
Sustain again as to what the individual who wrote the pieces of paper was intending to do.
Can you identify the information contained in this document as being consistent with what you've identified as subbooks?
No, I could not say that.
Okay.
Should we break now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, it's 4:30. We'll see you tomorrow morning at 9:30. Please do not discuss the matter among yourselves or with anyone. Leave your notes here, and we'll see you tomorrow morning. Good night.